$500 billion was spent on cloud computing last year. We've all heard of it, but what is it and how does it actually work? So to find out, I actually flew out to a real data center to understand how the cloud works and the infrastructure it needs to power billions of devices daily.
Too bad, actually. That's a lovely.
First, what is cloud computing? Well, here it is in 27 words. Cloud computing is the delivery of computing services like servers, storage, databases, networks, and more over the internet to offer faster innovation, resources, and economies at scale. Simplified, cloud computing is where you can get software, hardware, and computers through any device you want, replacing actual hardware in your place. But even more simple, computers go fast on internet. Now, the origins of the term cloud computing is disputed, but the cloud computing model of using a dumb machine to power a smart machine has been used in computing since the 60s. The IBM System 360 from 1964 was a mainframe computer ranging from 24 kilobytes to 1 megabyte of memory, depending on the model, and used a 32-bit processor architecture. Not only was it not feasible to use financially, it also weighed 1,700 pounds. This right here is a Raspberry Pi for comparison. Such a boomer thing to do. If you own one of these, you have to make that comparison. So in order for places like universities or businesses to use these machines, they would need to use a workstation or a data transmission terminal to put their required job into the queue, where the output will be given later. Essentially, a smaller, less powerful computer is used to pass jobs in a queue to a much larger, powerful machine. This, as well as another part of cloud computing, virtualization, was in its early parts of research. Eventually, instead of 10 machines, we will need 1,000. Instead of 10,000, we need 1,000,000. We need a centralized place to hold this data. You get it, data centers. So my buddy Jason and I went all the way over to OVHcloud in Montreal to check it out in person. Something that surprised me a lot was the amount of planning that goes into the geographical level of the data center. Outside of obvious reasons like security or proximity to users, natural things like disaster risk management, efficient environment usage, power availability are reasons someone would choose a place like this. So in Quebec, its cool climate was a big reason why the data center was here, considering this liquid cooling system that we will show shortly. And the security was really intense. We were asked this long questionnaire.
I'm not really have the right lens for this.
No, it's all good, bro.
Which makes sense considering that this data center has over 90,000 servers in it. Not many places are built to hold such a huge amount of computers, but this place actually used to be an aluminum factory right before the Second World War. It's funny how things work like that, huh? Now, 90,000 servers seems like a lot, and it is. But it's worth noting, though, that just because you have 90,000 servers doesn't mean that you can only hold 90,000 people on them. Virtualization allows a machine to simulate hardware and software using something called a hypervisor. The hypervisor allocates portions of the physical hardware to virtual machines that can all run independent of each other but on the same machine. For most compute tasks nowadays, you need something like a small web server rather than a giant machine. So by splitting it up this way, the cloud is able to rent out small parts of a server, which consumers don't have to pay for much. Allocation of physical hardware to virtual hardware varies depending on what cloud, but assuming a server has 64 cores, a 1-to-2 allocation ratio would mean 128 vCPUs. A 1-to-8 ratio would mean 512 vCPUs. Now, multiply this by 90,000 servers and you start to realize how the cloud becomes a ludicrous industry really fast. Now, for plebs like me, it's easy to click a launch server button on the cloud, but it's not easy to click a build server button. So at OVHcloud, they showed us their production line where they build all of their computers from scratch.
Where are we at right now?
We're gonna walk into our production facility. The production facility, we make between 500 and 600-ish on average servers per week. Then we can increase that number depending on what our customers need and demand that we have. So in one time where we had a very high demand, we actually almost doubled that number up to around 1,200 in a week. So
that's a ton of metal. But this is all part of a server lifecycle that goes in multiple stages. The high performance use is for what you are seeing. New hardware for high performance tasks, that's what the GPUs are for. These hardwares are built to handle the big workloads that use the most compute. After the major peak times or potential upgrades are available, these cards are then used for less demanding uses, maybe for non-critical business tasks, development environments, or any other thing that doesn't require a ton of compute. If the last option wasn't a thing, it is then fully decommissioned and recycled responsibly. Sadly, they denied when I asked if they could send it all to my house. Very, very sad. These servers are built based off of what is in demand. So for example, one of the biggest things is renting GPUs for training AI models. So,
do you have any H100s around like right now, like just showing?
I wish we did to show off. They're actually racked. Any H100 we have is being utilized at full capacity. We might have something we can show you a little later.
But you gotta lock those down. You know, lock those down there. They're the hottest thing right now, yeah.
Now that the computers are built, how do you even set up a server to operate alongside every other server? Well, what we saw at OVH was their own custom designed racks that, just like you see in stock footage, are designed to have rows and rows of servers. So what does the timeline look like from the server all the way to where it gets power? Well, here it is in reverse. So the server directly gets the power from a rack power distribution unit, which is mounted on the entire server rack and distributes power directly to the individual servers and equipment used. The remote power panels. Now this power comes from a remote power panel, which distributes power from a central source to multiple locations. Often there are multiple of these in extremely large rooms like the ones we were in. Power distribution unit takes the power from a single input source and uses that to distribute to multiple outlets. So in our case, it's the remote power panels, but this could be for literally anything. And what supplies the power distribution unit is an uninterruptible power supply. This is built to provide a continuous amount of reliable power at all times. However, when power goes out, the UPS switches to battery power to provide power when the utility grid is down. So in this case, a generator, which is massive when we saw it at OVHcloud. It was the first thing that we saw. Now, as you can see, cable management in my setup is sad. So seeing all of these cables managed is absolutely insane. On the servers themselves, Grafana is used to monitor and observe all the metrics of each virtual machine. Thank you, open source. This monitoring service can be put on the hypervisor, which overlooks key metrics of how the VM is being used without actually looking inside of the VM for privacy reasons. All of these metrics across all virtual machines are compiled and grouped to be monitored in the monitoring room, which was pretty awesome.
You can tell I'm nervous on camera.
Oh, you're good. You're
no,
doing good.
No, it doesn't show at all.
Good.
Oh yeah, you're perfect. Natural.
It looks like you're having a chat.
Good. That's what I was
starting to get
for.
Worried that you're overtaking me here. You know what I mean? You're becoming the star of the show.
OVH actually builds our own servers. We build all of our own servers from A to Z for the most part. Mm-hmm. We actually design our proprietary racks, everything like that, ourselves. So we laser cut our own racks out for the most part. And everything we build from the ground up, we're fully vertically integrated.
Vertically integrated, what does that mean?
So that means that we actually control our entire production line and we're able to facilitate kind of designing our servers based off of not, you know, being locked into some sort of vendor that prepackages them and builds them. We actually customize them based more off of what our customers want.
And so you can get like your fingers in every single little piece of the
pie. That's kind of it.
Okay, cool. So, yeah. To put it lightly, I guess you could say, right?
Now, I'm a 10X developer. It doesn't happen to me, but I hear that things break out of nowhere at times. One of the biggest things that's important when maintaining a data center of this size, or really any size, is making sure that everything is up to shape and working as expected. Servers often take a lot of time to just get up and running. OVHcloud told us about their zero-touch provisioning process, which means that when you connect the servers to the rack, they're automatically connected to the network and assigned an IP address. This also then provisions the server with the operating system needed to run correctly. Now, every facility handles alerts differently, but data centers typically monitor things like resource utilization. How is resources being used and is there any faults? How is the network connection? Are servers overheating, getting cold, underwater? Are systems down or up? Is any bad actor trying to play a dirty trick on us? This is where having over 90,000 servers makes sense. In situations where my supercritical application is on a faulty server through no fault of my own, automatic failover redirects my application to another server rather than having it recreate from scratch. Now, if you've ever opened up two Chrome tabs, you know what it's like to have a computer heat up your room fast. So what happens when it's now 90,000 of these computers? How do we make sure that this isn't a sauna and melts everything in the building?
It's pretty much warm here.
Yeah, very warm.
Just because about the design, you know? Mm-hmm. We were in the previous home where all the servers was in a small room, you know, and it was inside the room that the system and the air was recycling. Here, we have another technology I will show you. And so all the facility have the recycling of the air within this facility. So okay. Not directly inside the servers. That's the reason why here we are.
So when it comes to like controlling temperature, like that's a huge part of this whole entire operation then, huh?
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Yeah. And sorry, are these like networking cables then? Like
they're fiber optics. Yeah.
Okay. So funny enough, this architecture of servers being in rows is actually by design. Aisle containment method created a physical barrier between hot and cold air to prevent mixing. It's funny because in these clips here, it's noticeably warmer in between the servers and the complete opposite immediately after. But apart from that, there are a lot of ways that you can cool your servers through standard fan or liquid cooling practices. Cooling down servers using liquid cooling is one of the most popular ways data centers do it. Luckily, one of the strategic moves of starting a data center here in Quebec is being right by a large body of water. Cool water runs through pipes all through the data center and connects to the cooling systems. When heat is generated from the servers, the heat is transferred to the water, which absorbs it. This is then sent to radiators, 5,000 of them.
We could say that we have 5,000 of those radiators.
5,000,
yeah, wow. for all the servers we have in production here.
This warm water is then cooled back down and reused in the process. This reduces the carbon footprint significantly when running a data center like this. In order to catch all these different metrics, data centers often have a centralized monitoring location to analyze these metrics. And these metrics are often sent as raw data, and software like Grafana gives users the ability to group and visualize this data in whatever way they please. Commonly though, you will see graphs that track all servers in a single view, like average error rate, network throughput, power consumption, or more. But being able to get the metrics at the individual level is also extremely important. So imagine your task manager on Windows and being able to see 90,000 of them, or perhaps aggregating them all into just one result. But what happens when something wrong does happen? In these graphs, you create real-time alerts that notify you of any suspicious metrics. So when we went into the monitoring room at OVHcloud, this was the people who would be notified if something happened. It was pretty awesome. One of these guys had 4 cups of coffee on his desk, so I knew this guy had a lot of responsibility on him. When an incident comes up, someone will delegate the task to the proper person. Sometimes this could be them if they have the privileges to SSH into the machine themselves. And most of the time, people talk to each other on walkie-talkies, so pretty old school. It makes sense too, because the amount of servers in this building was absolutely insane. This corridor you see here is just one of many. I am not built for this type of exercise. I remember seeing videos of crypto mining farms and seeing how hot it got on those servers because of all the GPUs just running at full speed. Well, it's kind of the same now, except instead of virtual coins, we want anime girls to talk to us in funny ways. Data centers use a metric called power use of effectiveness, or PUE for short, to determine the effectiveness of the energy that's being used. OVHcloud's was 1.29, which means for every 100 watts of power that's being used, 29 powers of watts is used to control that metric, such as power and cooling devices and other overheads. So using the things like the liquid cooling systems we mentioned before would significantly bring that down. We basically just scratched the surface about how data centers work internally, but how do you secure this entire operation? Well, let's start with physical security. Every facility is different and has different technologies to help it secure, so we'll never have one answer. At OVHcloud, security was absolutely intense. We had to have a badge visible at all times, a hard hat, a security vest, and steel-tipped boots. And sadly, I can't say much more about the physical security of OVHcloud for obvious reasons, but let's just say I will never be doing a heist there anytime soon. But what happens when you send a network request to a data center? Starting from the network request, things like firewalls inspects incoming network traffic and filters out based on rules, maybe specific IP addresses or non-encrypted HTTP requests. Here is where something like an access control list could be implemented to hard ban specific IP addresses if needed. The server will have a network interface that routes the traffic to the appropriate server that it's looking for. Usually this information is compared with the information in your request, like API keys, security tokens, and more. The hypervisor is then responsible for rebuilding this request and pushing it to your virtual server. The hypervisor in this case is kind of like acting like a proxy. And this is when your firewall comes into play. Here you can set types of requests you want in, the specific IP addresses, and more. Usually you manage this on some sort of software like cPanel or some cloud provider. Even from a high level, these layers of security have to travel a lot in order to get through to your specific instance. Now imagine billions and billions of requests doing this daily. Just like any developer, I take the cloud for granted. But all of the things that go into making sure that my server stays up for 99.9% of the time is absolutely insane. Thanks to OVHcloud for flying me out to check out the facility. We had a blast and it was so cool to see all of the different things that make this experience easy. If you're interested in hosting an application, game server, website, or just need compute in some sort of way, then definitely check out OVHcloud. For me, I use their AI training notebooks to help train some AI meme captions in my last video that I did. It was really awesome. I was able to just clone my repository that I started working on my local computer. And then when I just need to get to the training part, I just did it on the OVHcloud with their new Tesla V100s. 40 gigabytes of VRAM is really cheap there, so it was easy. They also told me they ran a ton of Minecraft and Rust servers, so maybe try that as well if that's what you're into. Thanks for watching.